Welcome to Arbor Drive. Whether you're visiting us this morning or this is your home, we're happy that you are here. We're here to worship our God, to open our mouths and sing, to lift our hands in praise, to renew our minds with His truth, to be changed, to become more like our God. Would you stand and let's open in prayer this morning. Father God, you are great. We know there's power in your name. And you are here with us. And we just say thank you for that. Father, you are here for us. May we be here for you. For your glory, not for ours. May our focus be on you as we sing, as we witness a baptism, as we partake of communion, as we hear a sermon. Help us to keep our focus there, that our eyes are fixed on you and your glory. Help us to worship you the way you have created us to worship. Ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to open us this morning with a passage from Romans. This is Romans chapter 5. Since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That is amazing love. Amen. Amen. Now, let's sing together. His warning voice I hear, and He owns me as His child. I can no longer fear. With confidence I now draw nigh. With confidence I now draw nigh. And Father, Abba Father
are many. courage and strength always. And I will not fear, His promise is true. My God will come through always, and always. An amazing love, how can
love. You are our refuge and our strength. You rescue us from our pain. And as we think of that, as we meditate on that, we say, arise, my soul. Look at my God and worship Him. Father, we've declared it this morning. We've declared it in our hearts. We've declared it to each other. Help it to be true. May we worship You. May our souls arise and say, look at my God. And remember the amazing love that died for me, that died for us. Father, thank You for the reminder. Thank You for our voices, that we can lift them up, that we can sing, that we can feel passion for You through music. Father, help that passion continue as we witness a baptism, as we hear Your word through John, as we partake in communion. Help us be a people focused on You. We love You. It's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Please be seated.
Okay, hi, my name's Alana Weiss. Get baptized because baptism to me is a symbol of dedicating your life to Christ. I think baptism is important because, well, in Matthew 28, Jesus says, go make disciples of all nations and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so I think baptism is important because it's one thing that Jesus tells us to do, and also it is a symbol of dedicating your life to Him. So I think all of that together is important. I grew up in a Christian home, so I've always kind of been around God. I've been around learning about God in churches and everything like that. But it was something I was supposed to believe in and didn't choose to believe in, kind of thing. And then as I grew up and grew older and started understanding what it actually meant, I went to camp. I was at camp and I met people who told me their testimonies and how they came to know Christ. And so I just thought that was really cool. And I saw the work that He did for them in their lives. So I got to reading the Bible more and I worshiped more, and it became so much more real to me. And so kind of just like overflowing with relationship with God, and that's how I grew. And having like one-on-one time with people and prayer time with people, a lot of people helped me to grow in it. I don't think I could have done it on my own. My life has been different. I think I took on a whole new perspective when I started believing in Christ. Now, instead of just looking at everything, I look at it with, like, flowers, for instance. There's so many different kinds of flowers, and God is so amazing that He chooses to make different colors and different kinds, and chooses to make the world beautiful when He didn't have to. And I think that that's pretty amazing, and I think that He's just helped me a lot in becoming a happier person and before, now I can see the light a lot better. I can see things to be happy about. And when I struggle, I know that I still have somebody to lean on. Even when I feel alone, I'm not. And when I revert back to Christ, I know that. I'm like, He's here for me. I don't need to stress about things because it's in His hands and I have no power over it. So. Everyone starts out with the gospel, like, where do you think you'll go when you die, kind of thing. And along with that, I think I would tell them stuff that Christ has done in my life, and I would show them that it's actually a real thing and not just something that, you know, Christians try to persuade you into doing. And you have to know the person and know, like, what's gonna catch their attention, kind of thing. And if you tell amazing stories and you tell, you know, you can really feel the love in you when you worship God. You can feel that. You never know true love until you are actually fulfilled with Christ. God loves everyone. He made everyone, and He loves them so much that He sent His Son down to actually die for us. And what that means is basically, if you sin, when you sin, everyone's a sinner. You know, when you sin, it's forgiven. You don't have to live with that guilt on your shoulders every time. And although God knows what you did and He knows that you're gonna sin again, it's learning how to live through Him, and it's learning that, you know, you don't have to live with all of that sin on you, and you find Him and He forgives you and you're free of it. And then if you believe in Him and you believe that He did die on the cross for you because He loves you so much, then you go to heaven and you live eternal life and you get to meet Him and learn everything about Him, and instead of just dying.
Well, for those of you who don't know who Alana is, she has been a participant in Aftershock.
Okay, hi, my name.
She graduated a year ago. Yeah. So she's going in her sophomore year in college, and she contacted me, and we're here today now. And so I'm excited to be able to do this, and excited to have known her the last 5 years and to see the growth that she's had. It's been cool to see. So, Alana, are you now trusting in Jesus Christ alone for the forgiveness of your sins and the fulfillment of all of God's promises to you, even eternal life? Yes. Do you forsake Satan and all his works and all his ways?
I do.
Do you intend, with God's help, to obey Jesus' teaching and follow Him as your Lord?
Well, if you would, turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 6. Lord willing, we'll be finishing this up today. And as we prepare to look at this text, what I'd like to do is I want to show that there has been a mounting mounting opposition and an increasing resistance to Christ in this chapter, and there's also been an increasing offense by Christ in this chapter. So this morning as we began, as you're turning there, we start off, if you remember, in the beginning of this chapter with 5,000 men being fed. In verse 10, we see there were 5,000 men, which means there were probably more in women and children, and that it was a large crowd that was following him. And then we see the increasing offense by Christ. In verse 27, he offers food that endures to eternal life. In verse 29, he calls them to believe. He makes himself greater than Moses in verse 32, and he says that he comes down from heaven in verse 33, meaning that he was pre-existent, that he was incarnate, that he was God eternally existing in heaven, coming down from heaven. He claims to satisfy as the bread of life in verse 35. He tells them that they don't believe in verse 36. He tells them why they don't believe in verse 37. He assaults their sense of sovereignty, their sense of self-sovereignty in verses 37 through 44. He claims to be sent by God in verse 38. He claims they have the ability to save and keep in verse 40. He tells them they must be taught by God in verse 45. He claims to be the bread that manna pointed to in verses 47 through 51. He tells them they must eat of his flesh and drink of his blood in verse 53. He claims his flesh is true food in verse 55. And he tells them to feed on him in verse 57. This all happens, as we see in verse 71, at a synagogue. So what you can see is with Christ, you can see the increasing offense as he taught this people in this discourse. He started off very gently, and throughout the course of the whole chapter, he increases the offense as he talks to these people. And the Jewish response is increasing opposition. So in verse 26, they wanted their bellies filled. They followed him in verse 2. They wanted to make him a king in verse 15. They called him the prophet in verse 14. They followed him across the sea in verse 24. They questioned how to get the food that leads to eternal life in verse 28. They demanded signs in verse 30. They grumbled in verse 41. They used human reason in verse 42. We know this guy. We know his parents. This can't possibly be who he says he is. They disputed or argued in verse 52, and as we'll see today in verse 60, they said, "This is a hard saying, who can hear it?" And they left him. Now, as I said last week, chapter 6 of John is a heavy chapter, right? It's one of those chapters that as you preach through it, it's really, really difficult to preach through it, because at the beginning, everything seems so great, but it seems to progressively deteriorate throughout the entire chapter, ending with 11 people following him. Christ started with 5,000 men, 12 disciples, and at the end of the chapter, we're told that he has 11 with him. That seems like a not super fun chapter. And today, as we finish this, I hope that you will see that it is actually an extremely encouraging chapter for believers, for disciples. So, we'll pick it up in verse 60. Hang on. Technological difficulties here. Stand by. There we go. All right. What we see here in verse 60, notice here it says, when many of his disciples heard it. So the first thing I'd like to highlight here is they're called disciples. Okay, now throughout this chapter, we've seen reference to Jews. We've seen reference to the leadership. We've seen reference to people following him as disciples. But what I want to point out is these are disciples that are going to say this. Those who are following him. And the point here, as we'll see, is that being a disciple of Jesus does not necessarily mean being a Christian. So what I want to do is I want to break it down, and there's two types of disciples, right? There's these types of disciples. There's the disciples that followed him as long as it was convenient, that kept with him as long as they were getting their fill of bread. And then there's the disciples that I would call true disciples in chapter 8, verse 31. So it says there, so Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him. So first of all, he's talking to people that have believed. And he says, we have to get a hold of this. If you abide in my word, then you are truly my disciples. If you, person that has believed in Christ, abide, live, reside in his word, you are truly, truly my disciple. So a true disciple believes and abides, remains, rests, goes back to, lives in the word. So what we're going to see is later on, we're going to see that Christ says, the words I've spoken to you are spirit and life. These are the words of Christ. So the genuine ultimate test of a true disciple versus a false disciple is endurance. This is important because there are false disciples. There are people that follow Jesus as long as it is comfortable for them. There are people that follow Jesus as long as he does things their way. There are people that follow Jesus as long as they get what they want or he doesn't say things that are too hard. There are people that follow a Jesus that they've created in their mind, because to face the true incarnate Son of God, the one who has the authority from God to save us from our sins and keeps us, is an uncomfortable prospect because they don't like how he talks sometimes. So there are two kinds of disciples. There are true disciples and there are false disciples. There are disciples that follow when it's easy, and there are disciples that follow to the end. So in Revelation chapter 12, says this, and they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. That here is belief or profession. For they loved not their lives, even unto death. These disciples here loved not their lives, even to death. In other words, that they counted all as loss for the sake of Christ. They followed him to death. They were genuine disciples because at the end of their life, they were still believing and following in Christ. That's what a genuine disciple is. I pray every day that we would be a people that love not our lives even unto death. That as opposition mounts, we would not fall away. We would not compromise. We would not give up. But we would say, to live is Christ, to die is gain. I'm hard pressed between the two. I don't know which one to do. To depart with Christ is far better because I'm with him. But I remain here for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of his mission, for the sake of his kingdom. Then look at Philippians 1:6. And I'm sure of this. He that began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. That's endurance. That's grace-empowered endurance. So when we think of disciples, we have to understand that a disciple is not merely one who follows Christ for a little bit. It's one who follows him their entire life. They follows him from the time that they believe till death. There's an endurance there. There's a longevity to being a disciple. So it comes down to me, my comfort, or Christ and his kingdom, and we choose Christ and his kingdom. It comes down to me and my life, or Christ and the gospel, and we choose Christ and the gospel. That's a true disciple. Now notice what he says here. When the disciples heard it, they, that is, the disciples, said, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it?" This is a hard saying. So this word right here, hard, is not like hard to understand. It's not like it was a difficult concept to grasp. It carries the idea of harsh. They're saying this is a harsh thing. Notice here they also say this is a harsh saying. The word there is logos. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus is the Logos. He's the one that is come as the incarnate Word of God. And they're saying these sayings, these words that are coming out of your mouth are harsh. Who can hear them? Who can listen to it? Who can accept it? Well, there are few things that I want to observe here. First, Jesus speaks the words of God. We've seen that already in John chapter 5, verse 24, and we'll see it in John 12, 49. My words are not my own. I speak what the Father has told me to speak. Number two, Jesus is the incarnate Word of God. John chapter 1, verse 1 and verse 14. Notice that they not only reject Christ's words, but Christ as the Word. They're not only saying that these are hard things that you're saying, they're saying, we don't want to follow you. You're not the Messiah that we had in mind. You're not the one that we want to be around. And they finish it with, who can listen to it? Who can accept it? And we already know the answer because we've been through this in John chapter 6. Who can accept these hard things, these hard sayings of God? Number one, those that are taught by God. Number two, those who are given to the Son by God. Number three, those who are drawn by the Father to the Son. So what is it that Christ did or said that offended their sensibilities so much that these 5,000 people that went to these great lengths to be around him would say, this is a harsh thing. Who can hear it? We've seen already that they were more interested in food in verse 26, a political Messiah in verses 14 and 15, and miracles and signs in verse 30 and 31. Than the spiritual reality to which the food pointed. You see, all throughout this chapter, the Jews are looking to get their bellies filled, looking to get a political Messiah, and looking to see signs and miracles. They're not looking through that miracle that Christ did with feeding the 5,000 to see what it really points to. They're not being taught by God. They haven't internalized the external truth that's been taught to them. Number two, another thing that offended their sensibilities is they did not want to relinquish their own sovereign authority, even in religious matters, and therefore were incapable of exercising genuine faith. We saw this in verses 43 to 46. Christ, in this discourse, attacks the root of self-idolatry, of self-sovereignty, of us saying that we are the ultimate determining factor in things. That's a hard thing. That's a harsh thing that Christ says. He doesn't sugarcoat this. Number three, they're offended at Jesus' claim to be greater than Moses, sent by God and authorized to give life. We saw that in verses 32 and 58. And the final reason that they were offended is because the metaphor of bread, it was the metaphor of bread that ultimately was the straw that broke the camel's back. Especially when it assaulted taboos of eating flesh and drinking blood. See, Christ is not, as we talked about a couple weeks ago, Christ is not advocating cannibalism. He's saying, take me in, receive me, believe in me, feed on me and on my word. And you will have life. And especially in that culture where they drained animals, they drained the blood out of animals, they wouldn't eat meat that had blood in it, much less actually drink blood. That was really offensive language that he's using. He's talking to first century Jews, law keepers, ones who had grown up following the law. They knew what this meant. They knew you don't eat blood. You don't drink blood. And yet Christ does not choose some soft sell way of trying to convince them to believe in him. He increases in offensiveness. Now look at verses 61 and following. Verse 61, but Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples were grumbling about this, said to them, do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? What Christ is saying is, you think that's offensive? You think my saying, eat my flesh and drink my blood, is offensive? What if you saw me ascending to heaven to where I was before, at the right hand of God, co-equal with God, God himself? Now, how did Christ ascend to the Father? So there's descent down, ascent up. How did he ascend to the Father? He ascended by humbling himself to the point of death, even death on a cross. And therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him a name that is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. He was lifted on a cross. That's how he ascended to the Father. He was torn and pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we have been healed. You see, Christ going to the cross as the Messiah was the supreme scandal. The Jewish Messiah, the one who was supposed to deliver his people, hanging on a Roman cross. Nothing surpasses that in offense. Not even eating his flesh and drinking his blood. That's why Paul says in 1 Corinthians 1:23 and 24, but we preach Christ crucified. This is the central theme. This is the central message of Christianity. We preach Christ crucified. We talked about that a couple weeks ago. We don't just preach Christ as a good man. We don't just preach Christ as a moral teacher. We don't just preach Christ as a perfect man. We don't just preach Christ as the God man. We preach him as the incarnate Son of God crucified, hung on a cross. And that is a stumbling block to Jews and folly to the Gentiles. In other words, to this very day, there are many, many, many Jews in this world that do not worship Jesus Christ. And there are many, many Gentiles, when you hear this message of salvation and Christ crucified and that our healing comes through his death, they're like, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life. I mean, really, you can't clean this redemptive message up very much. There's a man and a woman naked in a garden, hanging out, and a talking snake comes. Says to the woman, hey, eat this fruit and you'll live forever. You'll be like God. So she eats it. And they're cursed. And then the whole rest of humanity, the whole rest of history, is God working to redeem a people for himself. And it culminates with God taking on the form of flesh and coming to earth to live as a human perfectly and to be crucified. That was the point of his life, was to come and be crucified. And then he raises again on the third day and hangs out for 40 days. And then all of a sudden, all these people start following him, and this religion spreads because of it. That sounds like foolishness to people that the Spirit is not teaching. But to those who are called, now notice here, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. So Christ is saying here when he says, what if you saw the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? He's saying the same thing that he was saying a couple chapters earlier when he said the Son of Man must be lifted up, like Moses holding up the pole with the serpent on it, right? The serpent was death. People were dying because of the serpents, and he raises this pole with the serpent on it, and they look to the serpent and believe, and they're healed. It's the exact same thing. He's saying the Messiah must go to the cross, must die. And how you respond to the central message of Christianity, a crucified Christ, will determine your eternity. Christ's biggest shame was in the moment of his greatest exaltation. So Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, looking to Christ, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame. In other words, counting the shame of the cross not worthy to be compared to the glory of being exalted at the right hand of the Father. Christ, when it looked like Christ had lost on the cross, that was when he accomplished his purpose and won forever. Purchasing his people, sealing it with his blood, ascending to the Father, doing what he came to do. And that, for a Jew that thought that the Messiah would be a political Messiah that would free them from the Romans, was blasphemous. Way more offensive than eating his flesh and drinking his blood. Verse 63, Christ said, is the Spirit who gives life. It is the Spirit that gives life, the Spirit that teaches, the Spirit that awakens, the Spirit that quickens, the Spirit that regenerates, the Spirit that takes out the heart of stone and puts in the heart of flesh. He says, the flesh is no help at all. Jesus reiterates what he has said earlier, namely, all that the Father gives will come. They must be taught of God. No one can come unless the Father draws, and Christ will lose none of them. It's a summary statement here. Spirit gives life, flesh is no help at all. We've already seen in John chapter 3 in his discussion with Nicodemus that it's the Spirit that gives life. Unless you're born of the Spirit, unless you're born again, you can't even see the kingdom of heaven, much less enter it. The fundamental problem with humanity is we need to be born again. We need the Holy Spirit to change us. And your flesh and my flesh is not contributing to that at all. In fact, if you think about it, our flesh rises up in opposition. Our flesh is always battling us. Our flesh is always trying to get us away from Christ. Even as a believer, right? Paul talks about it in warlike terms. We're at war at our flesh. We're killing our flesh. We're putting our flesh to death. We still struggle with the flesh. The flesh is always there. There's always this element of fallen carnality in us that seeks to satisfy the flesh. That's why there's affairs. That's why there's people that run around trying to make boatloads of money at the expense of others. That's why there's people that neglect their kids. That's why there are midlife crises. That's why there's people that go around living life feeling sorry for themselves. It's the flesh rising up constantly, 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 and we have to kill it. And the point that Christ is making here is that your flesh is not helping you in salvation. It is the Spirit that gives life. And then he says, the words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. I titled this sermon the church growth strategy of Christ. And here's why. My entire preaching ministry is built on this verse here. The words that Christ has spoken are spirit and life. It's the spirit is the product, the words are the product of the life-giving spirit, and the life, when it's internalized and believed, when the word is internalized and believed, that gives life. The spirit and the word are at work together. Now, the new birth is what he's talking about here. I want to show you something, and this is really amazing. Jeremiah 15:16. Your words were found, and I ate them. And your words became to me a joy and a delight of my heart. For I am called by your name, O Lord God of hosts. You can't feed on Christ without feeding on his word. You cannot feed on Christ without feeding on his word. Now here's the deal. Whenever Christ is preached, whenever the word is preached, it has an effect. We see this in this chapter, or we're going to see it in this chapter, but it has an effect. There's two effects that it has. Number one, it does something inside of us. It produces a joy. It produces a love. It produces an affection. It produces a conviction inside of us by the Holy Spirit taking it and applying it. Or it hardens us. Whenever Christ is preached, one of those two things will happen. So Paul says in 2 Corinthians 2:15-16, for we are the aroma of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. So there's two people. There's those who are being saved and there's those who are perishing. To one, a fragrance from death to death. That's this one here. That's those that are perishing. So to those people that are perishing, the word of God is a fragrance of death to death. To the other, a fragrance from life to life. In other words, to those who are being saved, the words that Christ has spoken are spirit and life, and it produces life through the Spirit. This is at the core of my preaching ministry here, okay? Like I couldn't come in every Sunday and go through this if I didn't believe this. So I believe that if I say week to week the hard things and the easy things that are in Scripture, if we go through verse by verse, chapter by chapter, book by book, and we deal with the hard stuff and the easy stuff, that over time we will be a healthier people, that we will have life. And the thing is that on any given Sunday, for maybe the last 7 Sundays, you might have felt like, geez, that's a hard thing. That's a hard saying. That sounds harsh. Who can hear that? I don't like it when people respond negatively to the word. I don't want the ministry of Isaiah, right? Go. Make the heart of this people dull. They'll listen, but they won't hear. Their eyes will be open, but they won't see. And he says, how long do I have to do this? That's not the type of ministry that I want. I don't want the ministry of Moses wandering 40 years through the wilderness and I'm not insinuating anything, but like a grumbling, complaining, dragging their feet people, and then Joshua comes after I leave and leads into the promised land. It's not like what preachers want when they start preaching. We want to see people saved. We want to see people growing. We want to see marriages reconciled. We want to see children and parents coming together and loving one another. We want to see husbands loving wives. We want to see ministry happening in the community. We want to see change in the community. We want to see people growing in their relationship with Christ. And that comes through a commitment to God's truth and his word, because you can't feed on Christ without feeding on his word. And what Christ says here is a divisive answer. They say, this is a hard thing. Who can hear it? He says, you think that's hard? Wait until you see how I'm going to ascend to the Father as the crucified Messiah. The Spirit gives life. Your flesh isn't any help. Everything that I've just said to you, that you said was so hard, that you said was so harsh, is spirit and life. That's a divisive thing that he says. Notice what happens here. Verse 64, there were some of you who do not believe. Christ is saying, I said before you didn't believe, and I'm saying again, there's still some of you that don't believe. And then he undergirds this entire argument with verse 65. And this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father. So we have to ask ourselves, right? So they're complaining. They're saying this is a hard thing. Who can listen to it? Is Christ a failure? I mean, it's a legitimate question to ask. Is Christ failing? The answer, verse 65, no, he's not. Because no one can come to him unless the Father who sent me grants it. And the result is sobering. Verse 66, after this, many of his disciples, many of those people that had been following him, who wanted to cross the sea from him or to get to him, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. Opposition, 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 opposition. People leave. Now again, I don't want people to leave. The reason I became a pastor was not so that people would leave. It's so that people would come. Come to Christ. And he's saying this here. He's inviting them. He's saying, come, come, come. And they don't come. They turn around. They walk away because of verse 65. No one can come to him unless it is granted by the Father. And it was not granted to these people by the Father to come. Now notice something here. This is fascinating. Notice what doesn't happen here. Jesus doesn't say, I'm so sorry. That was really harsh, guys. Really sorry about that. Got a little carried away. I really want you to follow me. Come on, please. Just come back. I won't say stuff like that anymore. Oh, I'll take it easy on you. That was out of line. sorry, got a little carried away. Had some coffee this morning. Got a little amped up. You guys were complaining. I said some things I didn't mean. He lets them leave. He lets them walk away. And he doesn't chase them down. He was not interested in meeting their felt needs, but he was interested in meeting their eternal needs. And he leaves them in their unbelief. In other words, they don't want the medicine for their soul. So if you've got a broken arm and you go to the doctor, it's a broken arm. It's not just like it's a broken arm, like bone sticking out. And you go to your doctor and he goes, it's not that bad. You don't need surgery. What we're going to do is we're just going to wrap this up so you don't see it. And we'll just sort of let it go. And, you know, it will give you some pain pills so it doesn't hurt anymore, and eventually it'll just recover and you'll be fine. Right? That's a bad doctor. That's a really bad doctor. Don't go to that doctor. You go to the doctor that's going to do what he needs to do to heal you, even though it might cause you temporary pain. They did not want the medicine that Christ provided for their souls. And let's be very honest, there are some hard things in Scripture. This is not the first, and it won't be the last. There are some things that Christ says that you just, what? Really? Matthew 23 is a prime example. 7 woes to the Pharisees. He calls them children of their father, the devil. You go across the sea to get a single proselyte, you make them twice as much a child of hell. Now, if I told you you go across the country to share the gospel with one person and you make him twice as much a child of hell, that's essentially what Christ is saying. That's not the easiest thing to hear. You brood of vipers, you hypocrites. Matthew 23 is scathing. But notice also how he treats his sheep. The woman at the well. Remember her? Tender, gentle, loving. Martin Luther said, with the sheep you cannot be too gentle, and with the wolves you cannot be too harsh. Because Christ was harsh with the wolves and gentle with the sheep. And he said hard things that we need as sheep. There are times when we need a good kick in the rear. And the Word of God provides that for us. So he doesn't remove the offense even. He doesn't run after them. In fact, look at what he does do in verse 67. So Jesus said to the 12. So now he's talking to the 12. Do you want to go away as well? Now, just picture this for a minute. You're in a synagogue and Christ is there and he's saying these really hard things and everybody's grumbling with one another. And then he says, why are you grumbling? The things I've spoken to you are spirit and life. That's why I told you, the spirit gives life. Flesh is no help at all. What? Wait, you thought that was offensive? Wait till you see me ascended on a cross. That's how I'm going to go back to my Father. That's how I'm going to save my people. Ugh, these are hard things. Who can listen to it? We're done. We're done. And just one by one, they start walking away from him. Thousands walking away from him. And then he turns to the 12, which I take this to mean that they're the ones that are left. And he gives them an out. This has been just as equally hard for them to hear as it was for the other Jews. And he gives them an out. He says, you want to go away too? You want out? You want to go with them? This blows my mind. I can't wrap my head around that. These people are all leaving him, and he's like, you guys want to go too? Now, at this point, every single church growth expert in the United States would be saying, you're an idiot. This is not how you build a church. You don't build a church by saying hard things. You don't build a church by saying, you want to go too? You build a church by being relevant. You build a church by appealing to people's sensitivities. And you shouldn't have ever mentioned feeding on your flesh and drinking your blood. That was just way too much for them to handle. No, you want to talk about sugar plum fairies and unicorns and how everybody everywhere is all okay and we just need to be better people. That's what a lot of church growth experts, that's what a lot of pastors would say. They would turn to him and say, dude, you're killing your ministry. You're ruining it. Yet Christ came with a message and delivered it unaltered, trusting that all who are given would come, drawn by God, taught by the Spirit, and would follow him to the end, since he keeps all that are his. Look at Simon Peter's response. I love Peter. Peter just doesn't even skip a beat, man. He's just right there. Peter said, Lord, to whom shall we go? That is a profound sentence. That's a profound question. You want to go too? Where else are we going to go? Who else are we going to go to? You have the words of eternal life. You're the one. You're the Messiah. You're the one that can save us from our sin. You're the Son of God. You're the anointed one of God. The one that's been promised for so long. Who in the world else are we going to go to? We could go hang out with John, the baptizer? No, we want to stay with you. Even with the hard things, Peter says, where else are we going to go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. This sounds a lot like the confession of Peter. Remember that? Who do people say I am? Okay, who do you say I am? You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but your Father who is in heaven. These guys are taught by God. And lest they get a little bit uppity at how smart or wise they were in following Christ and not walking away, Jesus answered, did I not choose you, the 12? And this right here blows my mind. I chose you, the 12. There's no grounds for you to boast here, Peter. In case you're getting a little uppity right now because you have a tendency to do that, I'm going to knock you down a peg. I chose you. But I also chose a devil. Did I not choose you, the 12? And yet one of you is the devil. Why Judas? Why mention Judas here? He mentions him twice in this section. First of all here, and yet one of you is the devil. And John interjects this. Because we haven't been introduced to Judas in John's gospel. Yes, John interjects this little note here. He spoke of Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, for he, one of the 12, was going to betray him. In John 6:64, I intentionally left that part out, if you've been following in your Bible. He says, for there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who those were who did not believe and who it was who would betray him. Why Judas? Why is he mentioned two times in this passage? This is chapter 6. We don't get to a point where he betrays Christ till later. We don't need Judas right now, right? The resistance looks like it's winning, and Jesus is a total failure. And my argument is that the reason that Judas is brought up twice here is because it serves to illustrate the larger overarching point of chapter 6. So what is the point or the main lesson of chapter 6? I would put to you that it is this. Whenever it seems like resistance to Jesus is winning in the world or in your life, God's people need a clear and robust vision of God's sovereignty over all things, especially resistance to Jesus. So when you as a believer are struggling, when you have things that are happening in your life that are trying to draw you away from Christ, when you have difficulties in life that you can't comprehend, you can't understand, when all hell breaks loose in your life, you need a clear, robust vision of God's sovereignty over everything, especially resistance. He also has sovereignty over you and the horrors in your life. So, as we finish up here, let's break this down. Christ's ministry goes from 5,000 plus to 11. And it seems like the resistance is winning. It seems like Christ is a failure. It sounds so negative. It seems like Satan is winning. And yet Christ mentions Judas twice, or Christ mentions him once, and John mentions him once. And the way they bring up Judas makes the main point of this chapter. So, verse 64, there are some of you who do not believe, for Jesus knew from the beginning who those were who did not believe and who it was that would betray him. Did I not choose you, the 12, and yet one of you is a devil? Some don't believe. Exhibit A, Judas. And God was completely sovereign over Judas being in the 12. Another way to say that is the devil is done. You think you've got control? You think you're running this show here? Look, I'm going to put you smack in the middle of my 12. And you're going to come on to this person, and he's going to betray me and send me to the cross. And just when you think that you're in control of things, I win. I defeat sin. I defeat death. I defeat Satan. And it's all because I put you here in my 12. That's what Christ is saying here. Judas doesn't come because it wasn't granted him to come, and God leaves him there forever. So in this, he's displaying the truth of verses 44 and verse 65. And it just ends. The chapter just ends. He was in a synagogue. Last verse. Boom. Done. No resolution. Mentions Judas twice in a synagogue. End of chapter. And look at this. He doesn't even tell them who it is. One of you is a devil. So there's 12 guys there. I chose you. One of you is a devil. He doesn't even tell them who it is. Doesn't really build camaraderie among the 12. They're just left wondering. What? Remember in the night when Jesus was betrayed? They were like asking, is it me? Is it me? Is it me? Yet God is in sovereign control of everything, including who he chose. The devil is in the middle of the 12 and will do exactly what God has purposed him to do. And it shows us that the devil is done. Now you can read this chapter, you can read the scripture in one of two ways. You can read scripture and see problem, 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 problem. You can say, all right, well then, you know, Judas was said, by Jesus said that Judas would betray him, and therefore Judas didn't have a choice, because if he didn't betray him, he'd make Christ a liar, and he can't make Christ a liar, so he had to betray him. So now he has no culpability in that because he had to. I don't want you to read scripture like that, because I don't think that's how God intends us to read scripture. Instead, you can read verse 70 and see a sanctuary of God's sovereignty in your life. You can read verse 70 and realize that no matter what is happening in your life, no matter how bad things get, no matter how much hell breaks loose in your life, nothing is out of the control of God. And he has everything in the palm of his hand and is working all things together for your good. So I think Scripture is designed for us to read because there's so many unanswered questions. So what does this mean for us? Number one, as believers, we need a robust, vibrant vision of God's sovereignty over all things, especially resistance. When things come up in your life that seek to pull you and draw you away from Christ, you as a follower of Christ need a big view of God's sovereignty, or else you have no hope. So Psalm 50:15, right? Call upon me in your day of trouble, and I will deliver you, and you will glorify me. How in the world can God deliver you if he's not in control of all of the elements in the world? And all the elements in your life, all of the things that are happening in your life. Romans 8. We know this. We know this. We know. We know this. We know that all things work together for good, for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. How can God work all things together for good if he's not in control of all things? So when your world explodes, and you're facing something that you can't explain, and you're in the middle of the valley of the shadow of death, you can fear no evil, for God is with you. And he is in control of everything, and he will deliver you through that. You fight sin in your life. You fight by grace. with the Word, so Ephesians chapter 6, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. It's the only offensive weapon in there. You fight your sin, trusting that God is sovereign and that He will bring you through that. As Paul said, for when I'm weak, He's strong. Therefore, I'll boast all the more gladly in my weakness. That doesn't sound like a lot of Christians today. It sounds like a lot of hypocrites. It sounds like a lot of Pharisees in churches today that say, I got this. I can handle this. I'm totally cool with it. Yeah, I'll work through this. I'll just pick myself up by my spiritual bootstraps, and I will get through this on my own. I'm not going to talk to anybody about that. Oh, man, heaven forbid we talk to anybody about that, because I am my own little God, and I can handle this on my own. When I'm weak, He is strong. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly in my weakness. My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. God is sovereignly over all things, especially resistance, and we need a robust, vibrant vision of that as believers. Greater is He who is in you than he who is in the world. Satan, flesh, the world, they can't win. We're more than conquerors through Him who loved us. Romans, just read Romans 8. Please, just go home and read Romans 8. It's all right there. It's amazing. Number two, God accomplishes His purpose through faithfulness to His word. The centrality of the word is essential to church health. Now listen to me when I say this, okay? My goal is not to drive people away. I love you, and I want you to stay. I want you to grow. I want you to see more of Christ. I don't want you to go away. That's not the point. But by the same token, if you have a problem with the hard things that Scripture says, and you say with this group, these are really harsh things. Who can hear them? And it's, caveat that, right? And I'm being faithful to the text. If I'm being faithful to the text, and that's what the text says, and you have an issue with that, then that's something that you need to work through. Because that's not going to change here. We're going to go through verse by verse, passage by passage, week by week, hard things and easy things alike. Things that are happy sermons and things that are hard, seemingly harsh sermons. We're going to do that because through faithfulness to His word, God builds His church. I planted, Apollos watered, God gave the growth. And there were many that were added to them daily, those that were being saved in Acts by God. So we are faithful to His word, even when it's hard for us to hear, and we walk through that together, and we talk through that together, and we come alongside of one another, and we work through those issues that the Spirit exposes through the word, and we leave together. And we do that week after week, month after month, year after year, and we will be healthier for that. Because if Christ didn't soft pedal it, I'm not going to soft pedal it, okay? I'm way more worried about my account that I've got to give before God than somebody coming up and being upset with me. Just being honest. Finally, when we come to believe, there is nothing in the world that can cause us to leave Him. We might walk away for a season in rebellion, but God disciplines those that are His, and those who aren't disciplined are illegitimate children. God is absolutely sovereign over circumstances in your life, including opposition to your belief. So when something happens in your life, and you don't want to believe anymore because the flesh is rising up, God will bring you through that. So the point of chapter 6 is this amazing declaration of hope for believers. That you're not alone. And thank God we're not in control. It's hope. It's joy. Our God has things under control, and we can trust in Him. We can rest in Him. We can rely on Him. And we have a peace and a comfort in Him that can't be explained. That we would never have were it not for Him and Him being God. I hope you see that. I hope you see this as an encouraging chapter. Because if you're in Christ, you're with Peter. Where else are we going to go? You have the words of eternal life. We've come to believe. We know you're the Son of God. We're not going anywhere, man. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the fact that we have nothing to fear. That we have nothing that can separate us from the love of Christ. That you are in control. And that you bring us safely through everything in our lives. Even the resistance to our faith, whether it's external or internal, you see us through that as your people. Father, I thank you that you have given us your word. And I thank you that it's not all just lollipops and fairy tales and unicorns, but there are real hard things that we need to wrestle through. And God, I just pray that every person here, as I said at the beginning of this series, not to take your Sunday school and bring it through this, but just to look at what God's word says and trust in God's word. Father, I just pray that you would take and you would send your Holy Spirit to minister to those that are finding these things really hard things, harsh sayings, that you would teach them and comfort them, that we would not be a people that finds problems in your word because we recognize that the problem is not your word, the problem is us, and that we would instead find a sanctuary in your sovereignty, a rest in times of trouble, in times of discouragement. That we could say with Peter, where else will we go? Who else are we going to go to? You have the words of eternal life. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's close, and we're gonna proclaim that He lives. We're just partaking. Let's celebrate that as we sing.
Yeah.
Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. Because he lives, we can go out and fill his commission for us. God bless you. Have a great week.